Funding for this firing line debate is made possible by grants from the John M. Olin Foundation and the Laurel Foundation.
From the Great Hall at the Cooper Union in New York City, welcome to a special firing line debate. Our topic is labor unions, and the resolution reads, "Resolved, labor unions are too powerful." Now, this might seem like an odd contention in 1997. Too powerful? In the 1950s, a third of the American workforce belonged to a union. Today, that figure is down to under 15%. Unions were once a major presence in American society and even in American culture. Today, they play a much smaller role. However, the unions believe they are making a comeback, and so do many of their critics. The AFL-CIO has an energetic new president, John Sweeney, and for the first time in a generation, unions are having some success in organizing growth industries like healthcare. And the unions spent a lot of money, with some success, helping Democrats in the last election. Critics say this is unfair, maybe even illegal. Defenders say unions are only doing for the Democrats what corporations have long done for the Republicans. I'm the moderator this evening. My name's Mike Kinsley, and I'm the editor of Slate Online Magazine at www.slate.com on the World Wide Web. I'm also a card-carrying member of a union, the Screen Actors Guild. That's the union Ronald Reagan used to be president of. I didn't vote for him there either. You're tipping your hand. We have eight debaters tonight, four on each side, all of them with lots to say. So let's not waste any more time before welcoming them now. Captain of the affirmative team is William F. Buckley, Jr., founder and star of Firing Line, founder of the National Review, author of books and columns beyond number. The sheer quantity of stuff Mr. Buckley produces would clearly constitute an unfair labor practice if he weren't his own boss. As it is, Mr. Buckley's productivity is clearly denying gainful employment to at least half a dozen other journalists. One of Mr. Buckley's famous remarks, and I hope I have this right, was in reply to Eleanor Roosevelt saying she wouldn't cross a picket line. Mr. Buckley proposed waiting until Mrs. Roosevelt was in Central Park and then setting up picket lines at all the exits. Now, Mr. Buckley, I hope I haven't denied you the opportunity to say that tonight. Or rather, I guess I hope I have denied you that opportunity. Walter Williams is chairman of the economics department at George Mason University in Virginia and author of many books. He is a regular substitute host for Rush Limbaugh on Rush Limbaugh's radio show. But enough about Professor Williams' scholarly endeavors. He also appears, according to his official biography, on TV shows such as Crossfire. Well, we all need a hobby. Jerry Jasinowski, also an economist, is president of the National Association of Manufacturers. Now, like the unions, the National Association of Manufacturers does not loom quite as large in American life as it did in the 1950s. But there are undoubtedly those who think it is still too powerful. Mr. Jasinowski is probably not among them. According to his official biography, he has appeared often on public affairs TV shows such as Crossfire. Finally on the affirmative team is Max Green, author of a recent book, Epitaph for American Labor, How Union Leaders Lost Touch with America. Mr. Green spent 10 years working for a union, the United Federation of Teachers. He later served as White House Associate Director of Public Liaison during the Reagan administration. He is now a financial advisor with American Express. Captain of the opposition team is an old friend of Firing Line, Robert Shrum. Mr. Shrum was chief speechwriter for the presidential campaigns of George McGovern and Edward M. Kennedy. He is now a leading Democratic political media and public relations consultant with the firm of Shrum, Devine, and Donilon. He also writes a column on advertising for Slate Online magazine, I hasten to point out. According to his official biography, Mr. Shrum is a frequent guest on CNN's Crossfire. Mr. Kuttner, Robert Kuttner, is co-founder and co-editor of The American Prospect, a monthly magazine of ideas. He also writes a syndicated newspaper column and another column for Business Week magazine. His most recent book is Everything for Sale, The Virtues and Limits of Markets. Mr. Kuttner's official biography mysteriously fails to note that he has often appeared on the CNN program Crossfire. George Becker is international president of the United Steelworkers Union and a vice president of the AFL-CIO. Before becoming a union official, he worked at Granite Steel, City Steel, and an aluminum plant owned by Dow Chemical. His official bio does not indicate whether he has ever appeared on Crossfire. And finally, on the opposition team, Mark Green, public advocate of the city of New York, the number two position in the town where we're broadcasting from today. Before becoming public advocate, Mr. Green was New York City's Commissioner of Consumer Affairs, and before that, he was for many years chief sidekick to Ralph Nader. And according to his official biography, he has, quote, appeared hundreds of times on programs like CNN's Crossfire. I've got to watch that show someday. So those are our debaters. Work rules tonight will be strictly enforced by this gavel. And I now call upon Mr. Buckley to propose the motion.
Mr. Chairman, ladies and gentlemen, some years ago, preparing to appear on a television program where I would give my views on a proposed treaty, a man with a clipboard approached me to say that after that day, I would not be permitted again to appear on television or radio. He spoke as a representative of AFTRA, the American Association of Television and Radio Artists. He gave me to sign an application for membership in the union whose terms would require me to observe all union picket lines. What ensued was a five-year lawsuit at which my attorneys pitched for what I thought were constitutional rights. I won a half victory. Yes, the court ruled I would need to join the union and to pay dues, but no, I would not be required to abide by its rules. My legal defense was paid by the National Right to Work Foundation, which also put forward the views of Mr. Beck a few years later, who told his union, thanks very much. He didn't want to contribute money for discretionary political spending by the union. The result was a stunning verdict, Beck versus Communication Workers of America, in which the Supreme Court ruled in 1988 that unions had no right to take money from their members for political purposes without their consent. Only the cost of collective bargaining, the court ruled, is legally taken from a member's wages. A survey went on subsequently to establish that only about 21% of the dues paid to the unions are typically spent on collective bargaining and collateral activity. Have the unions post-Beck reduced membership fees? Oh no, on the contrary. Last year, Mr. Sweeney, the head of AFL-CIO, ordained a surcharge, an extra $35 million to be directed, his own words, against Republican incumbents. Well, under the Beck decision, did dissenting union members get their money back? No. Well, doesn't that imply that the union members acquiesced in the effusive endorsement by the AFL-CIO of all Democratic candidates? No. It can't mean that because 30% of union members voted for Republican candidates and 9% for Perot. What it means is that most union members either A, don't know their rights are being ignored, or B, are frightened to assert those rights. During the past season, the AFL-CIO, especially under Mr. Sweeney, has gone rampageously leftist. Where once the unions cherished private property and free market practices, now the emphases are almost entirely redistributive. Where Mr. Gompers and Mr. Meany encouraged free trade, now the leadership is protectionist. In 29 of the 50 states, either you join the labor union or you don't get a job. 30% of the public school teachers in America are Republican, but 99% of political contributions from the teachers' unions went Democratic. True, there is the diminished reliance by the American worker on the labor unions mentioned by Mr. Kinsley. 30% in 1960, 11% today, and almost half of them public sector unions. But as the union's popularity diminishes, their popularity, their power and political arrogance increase. And what we are left with is a hugely wealthy, federally protected national engine devoted to the whole left agenda: high taxes, welfare, abortion, tariffs, race preferences, Clinton. Mr. Chairman, I move that this forum record its disapproval of these excesses.
Thank you, Mr. Buckley. Bob Shrum. Robert Shrum to oppose the motion.
In the long history of firing line, Bill Buckley has defended many fantastic propositions, ranging from the virtues of McCarthyism to Ronald Reagan's notion that air pollution comes from plants and trees. But seldom has he ventured as far from reality as he has today. His personal grievances aside, the proposition that unions are now too powerful ranks with the proposition that Mike Tyson fights fair. Mr. Kinsley pointed out the decline in union membership. At the height of union membership, we had three decades when real wages and benefits for people rose by 60%. But since 1973, real income for American workers has been largely stagnant. This isn't happening because profits are down. In 1995, profits rose 15%. Average CEO compensation in major companies soared by over 30% to $3.7 million. And factory workers' pay rose only 1% below the rate of inflation. One critical answer to this, I suggest to Mr. Buckley, is unions that are both more pervasive and more powerful. According to Business Week, a source that Bill and his team might like, union members earn on average 20% more in the same jobs than non-union members. Maybe that's why a recent survey reported that 34% of all non-union workers want to join a union. But today, the playing field is tilted for corporations that fiercely resist efforts to organize. They can and do imply that they'll move the plant overseas. They can and do run propaganda campaigns during work time, compel workers to attend them, and shut union organizers out entirely. It's like a firing line debate where the only one who gets to talk is Bill Buckley. And even though it's against the law, one in 20 union supporters gets fired. It takes, on average, a year and a half for the NLRB to hear their cases. And then employers can litigate endlessly in court, which they do at every stage of the process. How powerful are unions? Congress won't even pass basic labor law reform to change that. Finally, Mr. Buckley and his friends at the National Right to Work Committee damn unions for actually spending money in the campaign of 1996. It's one of the most important things the AFL-CIO has done in years. They're fighting back. But the fact is that they were massively outspent by business. I know why Mr. Buckley thinks unions are too powerful. They've even used what influence they do have to help push through every major social advance, from the 40-hour work week to civil rights laws to occupational health and safety, so you don't have to get sick or die simply to earn a paycheck. Last year, unions used what strength they had to help push through an increase in the minimum wage. Mr. Buckley sat with me on this program and said there would be much more unemployment. But much to Bill Buckley's discomfort, under Bill Clinton, unemployment is lower than it's been in 30 years. Mr. Buckley's prediction about the minimum wage has as much validity as Mr. Buckley's absurd proposition that unions are too powerful.
Thank you, Mr. Shrum. Professor Williams and Mr. Kuttner. Professor Williams, this is your chance to make an opening statement.
Thank you very much, and thank you for the very courteous introduction you gave our opponents. Like any liberty-loving American, I believe in voluntary associations between people. That is, I support the right for people to form and join work associations, like labor unions. But labor unions have gone beyond simply voluntary associations to government-backed collusions against other workers. Unions typically refer to the strike as their ultimate weapon, but the strike is not. Their real power is a result of their ability to use government or violence to prevent other workers from competing with union workers for jobs. That is, a non-union worker cannot form a contract with an employer on mutually agreeable terms. If unions could not prevent employers from hiring others in their places, all that a strike would be a mass resignation. We see that by remembering the air traffic controller strike. It failed because the union could not prevent the FAA from hiring other workers in their places. This observation shows that contrary to the typical argument that the union struggle for higher wages is primarily a struggle or collusion against other workers rather than employers. Should anyone doubt this, it can be cleared up simply by asking my colleagues whether they would support a law allowing employers to negotiate independently with workers, be they union members or non-union members. Ask them that.
Thank you. Don't leave, no, Professor. Mr. Kuttner.
Thank you. Well, this proposition might have been a reasonable debating proposition 30 or 40 years ago, but given the recent history of the declining membership of unions, it is absurd to argue that unions are too weak, and I would make the case that absurd to argue that unions are too strong, and I would make the case that, if anything, unions are too weak. First of all, the democratic revolutions that swept the West in the 18th and 19th centuries stopped at the door of the workplace. In a workplace, you are there as an employee at the sufferance of the boss. A union is the only institution that has a degree of worker voice that brings rights of democratic citizenship into the workplace. And the fact that in a union shop you need to become a member of the union or at least pay union dues is a minor offset to the fact that the union is the only representation of worker voice that you have. Everything else is top down, from what the boss pays you to the boss's right to fire you at his pleasure or move the whole company overseas. Now, in the 30 years after World War II, when unions were about three times as strong as they are today, the wage of the average worker doubled in a generation. In the 20 years that followed, wages have been just about flat, and they have been becoming more gradually unequal, whereas they've become very high at the very top. How can it be that the golden age of unionism coincided with the golden age of American capitalism if a weak labor movement is a good thing for the average American?
Thank you, Mr. Kuttner. Professor Williams, you can question Mr. Kuttner now.
Well, Mr. Kuttner, your suggestion, your statement implies that we receive higher wages in the United States as a result of union activity. Would you suggest that if we went to Bangladesh and suggested to their legislature that they build strong unions like we have in the United States, their wages and their incomes would be as high as ours?
Well, it wouldn't be as high as ours because the Bangladesh economy as a whole is less productive than ours. However, they might be higher than 50 cents a day, and it probably would be a very good thing for Bangladeshi workers to start organizing unions because because the workers in that country and in a lot of other Asian countries are so thoroughly exploited by multinational enterprise that children are forced to work. I think a union is exactly what Bangladesh needs.
Okay, but so you see no relationship between wages and worker productivity. That is, the capital, the education, that is, all the tools that Americans have to work with. That is, an American person building a road, he's moving on top of an earth mover building that road. Mm-hmm. And whereby in Bangladesh they may be using shovels to build a road. And so it's the higher productivity of the workers that explains higher wages, not unions.
Well, I would give you two rejoinders to that. Of course, in general, it's the higher productivity that determines living standards. But unions can influence who shares in that productivity. And if you had stronger unions in the United States today, and for that matter in Bangladesh, you wouldn't have the trend of the chief executive of the company and the shareholders getting more and more of the money and workers getting less and less of the money. So it's a question not only of the level of the productivity, but how the benefits of that productivity are shared. And secondly, a number of studies do suggest that when workers are paid more attention, when workers have a voice, productivity gains often result because workers know a lot of things that they're not anxious to share with the boss when their very livelihood is in jeopardy.
And keep in mind that workers are a large percentage of the owners of stock shares.
Well, actually, they're a relatively small percentage. It's about 30%.
No, well, my colleague is going to tell us much more about that later on. Unions in the United States support the same kinds of activities that racist unions in South Africa support. For example, unions in South Africa, in my book I point out a number of quotes, and it's called the South Africa's War Against Capitalism. Racist unions in South Africa who would never have a black as a member say, we support the minimum wage law for blacks to protect white workers from having to compete with low-skill, low-wage black workers. Do you think that unions in the United States have the same motivation? Keeping in mind that it was Samuel Gompers who wrote Meat and Rice, Meat versus Rice, saying that we ought to provide meat for Americans rather than to have them compete with low-life Chinese.
Well, the whole point of a minimum wage is to take labor to a degree, to take wages to a degree out of competition, so that when you have a period of high unemployment, somebody who's more desperate and more destitute than you are doesn't take your job away. If you raise the floor overall, either through a minimum wage or better yet through collective bargaining, you don't have workers of different races or different backgrounds being played off against each other. But I think more importantly, since you raised the question of race and civil rights, I think in fairness, yes, there have been periods of American labor history when unions were racist, and there have been particular unions as recently as the 1960s and 70s in the building trades that did not have a very good record on rights of minorities. On the other hand, all of the great civil rights laws became law in large part because of the work of the labor movement. And if you want to go to an institution that is democratically run, that has people of all races working together, go to a union hall. Go look at a rank-and-file meeting of the auto workers, the steel workers, AFSCME, the SEIU, any of the other great unions that have been forces for racial progress and civil rights.
Okay, would that democracy also extend, in your opinion, to the Greyhound strike or the coal strikes in the western part of Virginia, where union members were shooting at buses and shooting at workers who went to work as a result of so-called scabs who did not go along with the union's position? Would that democratic principle apply to that activity as well?
Mr. Kuttner, you can answer that question and then start asking questions.
There have been isolated cases of violence in the history of the labor movement, but the violence against workers by industry has been far more systemic and far more pervasive and far quieter. When a company promiscuously relocates overseas and tens of thousands of people lose their livelihoods, that's a form of violence. And let me... Let me turn that into a question. Do you think that a company to which a worker has been loyal for 10 or 20 or 30 years owes that worker anything in return other than tomorrow's paycheck and goodbye if we don't need you?
Well, it all depends on the nature of the contract. That is, if the contract says that I'm going to employ you for the rest of your life, well, then the employer is obligated to do so. But if in absence of contract, we have common law that states what the worker contract is, and it's normally agreed, or normally, I think a lawyer could correct me, it's a month-to-month basis.
And you think that's a good way of organizing the work relation?
Well, it's according to common law. Now, if you want to change the law, then go ahead and do it. But that's the law.
But I'm just asking you as an individual, do you think that's a good way of organizing relations between employers, between corporations, and individual employees, that the corporation owes nothing?
I think the worker should, a worker and employer should earn the loyalty. That is, a worker can just as soon leave an employer. Would you be against that?
No. But do you think the bargaining power is symmetrical between an individual worker and a multi-billion dollar corporation?
Well, if I had more time, I would show you that the notion of bargaining power is a vacuous concept.
There's no such thing as bargaining power.
It does not mean anything. Let me just kind of give you an example of that. At George Mason University, where I teach, I'm very sure that they would like to be able to hire me for $5,000 a year. It would be a windfall to them. But why can't they do that? They have superior bargaining power, if I use your language, to me. Well, it's because of other offers I would get out there much greater than $5,000. That is, the greater the number of people competing for my labor services, the higher the wage I can command.
Well, that's true of college professors. Do you think that's true? You think that's true of rank and file workers?
Yes, I do.
In a climate where there's 10 million people unemployed, you think that the bargaining power between the individual employee in the absence of a union and the absence of collective bargaining power and the corporation, that's that one employee, as the old labor song has it, the feeble strength of one, against a multi-billion dollar corporation, you think they're actually equal bargainers?
They have just as much bargaining power as I have with the state of Virginia. Which means that the state of Virginia, they have the power to say what price they will pay me for my services. And I have the power to say how many hours I will offer at that price. Everybody has that power.
Yes, but different individuals. Bill Buckley, as an entertainer, a debater, a prominent conservative, doesn't have the same degree of bargaining power as the average rank-and-file employee, and neither do you and neither do I.
I have more bargaining power than Bill Buckley. I'm far more handsome.
The Dunlop Commission, which my Captain Bob Shrum quoted, reported that one non-union worker in three would like to join a union. But because corporations routinely have stopped obeying the Wagner Act, it's almost impossible to organize a union without being summarily fired. Do you think that's a good thing, if you believe in the right of association?
No, I don't. I mean, if a worker has the right to join a union, and if someone prevents him from joining a union, I think that person ought to go to jail.
So I count you as an advocate for labor law reform. Will you go help me lobby for labor law reform? Will you write in favor of labor law reform?
I would get rid of all labor laws except the one that reads, so far in that respect, that people have the right to form voluntary associations. Namely, if I want to work for an employer without joining a union, I have that right. If you want to work for an employer joining a union, you have that right.
And you think there should be no retaliation against workers for joining unions or organizing unions?
No, I do not.
I'm delighted to hear that, sir.
Thank you very much, both of you. Mr. Jasinowski, it's your turn to make an opening statement and then submit to questioning from the opposition team.
Thank you very much. I think the central reality of today's world, I think everyone here would agree, is that we live in a new economy where the old rules have changed. Anybody who doesn't see that is not looking around. There's competition everywhere. You can't raise prices. You've got to compete harder. You've got to use technology. You've got to use your brains. In fact, to be successful in today's high technology economy, you've got to constantly change and improve. If that's the central reality of today's world, the central challenge is to empower our workers in every single way that we can. Whether or not you're management or labor, and it's arrogant to think that management or labor leaders ought to be telling workers as individuals what they should do. What we should in fact do is, in the tradition of American labor, I worked my way through college in factories as a union leader, and at that point in time, unions were a progressive, vital force for change and reform at every level. But in recent years, they have become the leadership, in too many cases, the defenders of the status quo and the opponents of change and reform at every turn. It is in the interest of workers to, in fact, see Medicare reform. It's in their interest to see their taxes cut. It's in their interest to see their education improved. And in all of these cases, time after time, labor, organized labor leaders have opposed those changes.
Thank you. Who would like to start the question? Mr. Becker.
Can we go forward on questions or do I get mine out?
No, you just ask your questions right from the table.
Well, I'll start. Jerry, you talk about the need to economize, to keep prices down, to compete in the world. Do you think that means that perhaps CEOs should put a brake on the immense salaries they're giving themselves in many cases for downsizing?
Absolutely. It seems to me that CEO compensation is part of the old rules, which are wrong. There are lots of cases where CEOs may make too much money, but we are not in the business here of deciding. That's the board of directors. What we ought to do is empower workers so that instead of focusing on the minimum wage, we focus on providing stock, we focus on incentive compensation, we focus on ways in which the wealth go to people at all levels.
Well, do you think unions, where instead of the NAM lecturing workers on what's in their best interest, the workers themselves get to define their interest, do you think unions are a good way of empowering workers?
I think in some cases, unions at the local level are a good way, and in certain cases, certainly George has provided that. But in too many cases, what you have are the union leaders in Washington opposing all of those policies that would, in fact, benefit their workers, and in that way, misusing power.
Mr. Becker.
If you believe unions are too strong, how do you explain the fact that wages are down, that benefits are down, and productivity is up?
First of all, the workers in unions are not too strong. The leaders at the top level are too strong in pursuing an agenda that is not in the interest of workers. They're not for tax cuts, which are the way you could raise the living standard. They're not for smaller government. They're not for expanded trade so that you can compete and improve growth. They're not for a growth agenda. And that's why, in fact, we don't have a declining economy, George. We have, in fact, the best economic record we've had in decades. And it includes, in many cases, for workers, because we now have 5% unemployment.
You seem to imply that labor leaders are sticks in the mud out of step with their union membership. Don't you think that labor leaders who fought against the Gingrich Revolution, against severe cuts in Medicare, against tax cuts for the rich, the very rich, and for minimum wage legislation, don't you think they were reflecting the overwhelming majority of their members on those issues?
In fact, they were not, because
Jerry, do you do no polling at the NAM?
In fact, they were not representing the overwhelming majority of their workers. Workers all believe that whether or not it's Medicare or Social Security, there needs to be reform, get rid of the waste, improve those systems. They also think their taxes ought to be cut. You know, taxes at all levels have doubled in the last 20 years for the average worker. If you talk about why their wages are down, it's now because the typical worker gives 40% of his income for taxes instead of 20% back in the 1950s.
Jerry, I can understand why you ardently believe that, but you should also believe Lou Harris and Associates. When they polled members of unions on the four issues I indicated, they disagreed with you, they disagreed with Gingrich, they disagreed with Buckley, and they agree with their labor membership. You may not like those beliefs, but you can't dispute the fact that in those instances, union presidents reflected their members, if not you.
You know, whether or not you have a particular poll, which can show lots of different things, Mark, the fact of the matter is I suggest that union workers want to see their taxes cut, and that's part of the debate in Congress now. Why is it that union leaders oppose that? Or why do they oppose compensatory time instead of overtime, where many of their workers, in fact, want that?
You know, this is almost surreal. This reminds me of Brezhnev saying, I have nothing against the American people. There's American leaders I don't like. Where does the NAM get off
purporting to speak for American workers. This I mean, your member
Bob,
companies
Bob,
do it. No, let me finish.
Let me.
Every day of the week. This is why we need unions, so that the NAM doesn't get to stand there and say, this is what American workers really think. They just don't know it.
Let me just tell you that the rules have changed. 90% of the workers in this country are not unionized. I came to this room. My son, Abe Jasinowski, was in fact graduating. And a man named Hoberman came to this room and told the graduates, it's time to focus on how you actualize by being more entrepreneurial, change, improve, and challenge the system. That's what those graduates were told. That's what workers should be told by management and labor. Let's not pretend that management represents workers by themselves. Let's free up workers so they, in fact, represent themselves.
Comment, you mentioned the comp time. The only institutions that's proposing comp time is business, is the National Association of Manufacturers, the Chamber of Commerce, the Right to Work Committee. Those are the institutions. There's no worker institution proposing that.
George,
those people need that money. What you're doing is shifting the work hours for 80 hours over a week. It can work 10 hours in 1 week. It could work 70 hours in the next week.
George, why is it that you don't want to let workers choose?
Let
workers choose if they want to take time off instead of having additional
overtime.
The workers
aren't choosing. You're choosing.
Okay. I don't want to choose.
Okay.
Let's let the workers choose.
Thank you, gentlemen. Thank you very much, Mr. Jasinowski. Mr. Becker. It's your chance to make an opening statement.
Thank you very much. The answer to the questions, are labor unions too powerful, depends entirely, to borrow a timeless question, on which side you're on. If you're on the side of the CEOs, who make more in a month than the average worker makes in a lifetime, then certainly unions who raise wages for ordinary workers are too powerful. If you're on the side of huge multinational corporations that are enjoying record profits as they roam the globe in their endless search for dollar-a-day labor with which to blackmail American workers, then certainly unions, which stand up against this kind of exploitation, are too powerful. If you're on the side of those who want to destroy Social Security and Medicare and lower the minimum wage and eliminate regulations governing workplace safety, then certainly unions, which have led the fight for protecting Social Security and Medicare, creating a livable minimum wage, and making the workplace safer, are too powerful. If, on the other hand, you are on the side of American workers who are running faster and faster to stay in place, on the side of American families who find the American dream vanishing before their eyes, on the side of working women trapped in dead-end jobs, on the side of blacks and Hispanics falling further and further behind, then you know that America can only get back on track with a stronger labor movement.
Thank you, Mr. Becker. Don't go away. Mr. Jasinowski. Mr. Green, you start the questioning, please.
Yes, I would just ask you, Mr. Becker, if the American workers see the American dream vanishing before their very eyes, why is it that the kind of polls Mr. Green was referring to show that the vast majority of American workers think that economic conditions in America are good?
Well, one thing I would submit is you're looking in the wrong place. You're not going to find it within the Beltway in Washington. You're not going to find it within the academic circles. Go down to Braddock, go into Homestead, go into Granite City, Illinois, go into Johnstown and examine what's happening there to people.
No, I'm talking about polls of union members that show that the vast majority think that economic conditions in the United States at the present time are good. At the same time that you are saying, and it must be a contradiction, that they are perceiving their dreams as vanishing.
The single family supported job in America is gone. In most families today, both spouses work, and between the two of them, can't equal what one factory, one family supportive job paid back in the mid 70s. Daycare is a way of life. They see their children on shifts. And between the two of them struggling, they can't do that. The standard of living in America is declining. It has been declining.
If I could ask one follow-up question regarding that, I'm sorry. The standard of living between 1970 and 1990 has declined. Isn't it a fact that during that period, The space per household of the average size house has increased dramatically. Isn't it a fact that that vacation time has increased dramatically during that period? Isn't it a fact that vastly more people have TV sets, VCRs, computers? Doesn't that show to the contrary that standard of living has increased?
You're looking in the wrong place. Look in the real life of America. That's really not the case. Youngsters coming into the job market today are working at minimum wage. They don't have health care benefits, and the prospect of them ever having them or meaningful retirement policies are gone.
George, you're preaching doom and gloom in the land which has more opportunity than any other country in the world. But I want to leave that aside and ask you directly about Social Security. I want to ask you directly about Social Security. The workers' principal reason the standard of living has not gone up in the last 10 years is because payroll taxes have gone from $5 to $500 billion. And at the same time, the return on Social Security is not great. Why don't we reform it? Let the worker use some of his now payroll tax to invest in the stock market like everybody else and get the gains.
Gary, I'm not an economist, but I'll tell you this. That if we keep America's economy limping along on a low growth rate of 1% or 1.5%, we're never going to be able to fund the kind of social benefits that we need in America.
We ought to have higher growth.
Kick the economy up to 2%, 3%, 4%, and let it run. We talk about a free market economy. Let the marketplace decide. We do that, except when too many workers get a job. Then the Federal Reserve wants to come in and put the screws to it, kick interest rates up, and force people to be laid off. Is that the marketplace deciding?
The way you get growth is to cut taxes, reform Social Security, and improve all those things that are necessary to get productivity, George.
Productivity has been rising. If you go back from the 70s, and you look at the productivity increases in America, it's been on a steady climb. For a long time in our history, the wages paralleled. Fact is, the wages was a little bit higher than productivity gains. In the 80s, that stopped. Productivity kept going straight up, wages flattened out, and then started to fall. This is history. I'm not an economist, but I can read charts.
Professor Williams.
I have a question, a kind of follow-up on Social Security as well, and it's of some intimate value to me. The Social Security tax is the highest tax that the median worker pays, even more than income tax. Now, let me just kind of put a racial focus on it a little bit. Now, and I and my brothers, my black brothers and sisters, our life expectancy is like 65. And you only get your Social Security benefits at 65. Now, I'm paying all these taxes, and comes time for me to get my Social Security check, I'm dead. I mean, do you support that? And then also, people on your side are saying, raise the retirement level to 70.
I don't want to make this personal.
No, but
whether you're going to be dead or not. But I want to respond on something on a racial
but
end.
What do you think about that?
That you've said a little. I'm not an economist, so I really can't track the money.
I'm just pretending.
You raised a question on racial sensitivity, and I want you to know that I was particularly offended by a lot of what you said. Our union. We have four international officers, one of which is a black vice president.
Were you disagreeing
with our relationship within the makeup of our union is roughly 40-60%. We have a lot of black leadership. We were the leaders in the struggle for the Civil Rights Act in 1964. Our people bled and fought for that as much as anybody. We've been a champion of women's rights, a champion of Hispanics' rights. We're very proud of what we do. And I resent any implication that the leadership of the industrial unions in America are racially blind.
Thank you very much on behalf of me and my people. But you did not answer my Social Security tax question.
Well, that's one of the frustrating things for people on both sides of these debates. Thank you very much, Mr. Becker. Max Green, your opportunity to make an opening statement. Mr. Green. The podium is yours.
Over the past generation, the American labor movement has undergone a radical transformation. As late as the late 1960s, a strong case could be made that it remained true to the founding philosophy of its founder and first president, Samuel Gompers. That was a founding philosophy that distinguished the American labor movement from the political socialist movements of Europe. The American labor movement, as against what they were doing in Europe, said that it would advance the cause of workers primarily through organizing and through collective bargaining. And as far as association with the left wing of American politics was concerned, it was to be avoided like the plague. But due to heightened competition in the international and domestic economy over the past 20 years, the original strategy of the labor movement in America has been rendered very ineffective, as evidenced by the decline, which we've heard about this evening, of the percentage of private sector workers that are organized, down from 35% in the 1950s to somewhere between 10 and 11% today. And this decline, by the way, occurred during Democratic administrations, liberal Democratic administrations, including the current Clinton administration, when the National Labor Relations Board, which administers these matters, is headed by a very pro-labor liberal chairman. So it doesn't have to do with the administration of the laws. It has to do with the ineffectiveness and unattractiveness of unions in the current environment.
Why don't you hold off right there and submit to some questioning. Mr. Kuttner.
I think I heard you say that as late as the 1960s, the labor movement was true to its roots. It wasn't this sort of radical creature. Maybe I read labor history differently than you do, but didn't the great growth in the 30s, 40s, and 50s come from industrial unions, from people like Walter Reuther, who were sort of well to the left of the crowd that was in power in the 70s and 80s? Do you read the same history books I do?
Yes, I do. And the fact is that many of the industrial labor leaders came out of the socialist movement, just as Samuel Gompers originally came out of the socialist movement. But Walter Reuther came to the view that Samuel Gompers had, that the American trade union movement, whether he's right or wrong is another question. He came to the view that the American labor movement could create, in his words, a new middle class through negotiation and collective bargaining, not through politics. And that's why he, like Samuel Gompers, abandoned the socialist political movement.
Didn't he embrace the Democratic Party, though?
He was involved in the Democratic Party, but he was charged as recently as a book that was written by a biographer of his 2 years ago with having abandoned his radical origins and having adopted the philosophy of Samuel Gompers.
Mr. Becker.
Quit trying to put the labor movement in a box, whether it's right, left, up, or down. Every bit of social legislation that's been passed in this country in my lifetime, starting with FDR's New Deal, whether we're to the right or to the left, has been through the connection, the coalitions between the Democratic Party and the labor movement. Start with Social Security, look at the more recent ones with Medicare, family leave, look at unemployment, workman's compensation, look at the Clean Air Act, the Clean Water Act, the toxic substances, everything from child labor. This has all been championed by the labor movement, regardless of what political leanings the individual leaders may have had at that time. It's made no difference in there. We're a social organization. We respond to our people. We're elected by our people. I stand for election on a referendum vote with every member of our union once every 4 years.
Okay. Well, you know as well as I do, Mr. Becker, that union leaders are not chosen on the basis of whether or not their politics agree with those of their members. I remember not so many years ago, William Wimpensinger was a member of the Socialist Party at that time. His members knew nothing about it and probably cared nothing about it. The members of the AFL-CIO are not socialist. In 1995, the president of the AFL-CIO, John Sweeney, joined the Democratic Socialists of America. So there's a disconnect, and there has been in times past, between the politics of the leaders of labor and the politics of American workers. And American workers, by the way, traditionally, in poll after poll, have said that they do not want union leaders to be primarily involved in politics, and they have shown time and again that through various ways that they do not often share the political views of their leadership.
Mr. Shrum, I read this morning in the Wall Street Journal that Hong Kong has just suspended bargaining rights, collective bargaining for the workers in Hong Kong. It doesn't make any difference which way those workers lean. Their representative, their choice of collective representation has been destroyed. We're fighting very hard to protect that in the United States and maintain it.
Well, I would stand with what Professor Williams said, which is that workers everywhere here in Hong Kong should have the right to voluntarily associate
Mr.
in the
Shrum.
Manner in which they want.
Can we get away from labels and this left stuff for a minute?
Well, there is such a thing.
I know you're gonna try to prevent yourself from having to be pushed out of them, but I'm gonna try to push you out of them. Walter Reuther was an original advocate of the Civil Rights Bill. He was a strong advocate of national health insurance. The labor movement has fought for minimum wage, to protect Medicare, for occupational health and safety, all the things George and I have talked about. Are those the terrible, sinister, left-wing measures you're concerned about that have so alienated their members in your mind?
No,
or what are they?
Well, I'm concerned about things like free trade. Walter Reuther and George Meany after World War II were in favor of free trade. The American labor movement today is the staunchest opponent of free trade in this society. The UAW during Walter Reuther's union during the 40s and early 50s, the AFL-CIO under George Meany was opposed to discrimination. The AFL-CIO today stands squarely behind reverse discrimination, preferential treatment on the basis of race.
I've got it. It's affirmative action and the fact that labor desires that in trade agreements we have some standards to prevent massive pollution of the environment and very low wages in other countries pushing wages down here. That's leftist.
What happened is that the American labor movement... Yes. Oh. Yes, economic protectionism was the policy of the British labor movement when it was a socialist movement, and it tried to insulate England from competition. And that was a left-wing attack on free trade, and that's
you're in
what
Britain.
We see.
You're not in
exactly
Britain, you're in America.
What we see, on the part of the AFL-CIO today.
Thank you very much, Mr. Green. Thank you. Not to be confused with Max Green, Mark Green will now make an opening statement.
As for the absurdity of the proposition that labor is too powerful, about everything has been said, but not everyone has said it. And so let me add to the sentiment that Brother Shrum began by. The Gallup organization has for years polled the public about the power of large institutions. And while between 1968 and 1993, the number of people who thought that big business was too powerful doubled, the percentage of Americans who thought that labor was too powerful fell from 26% down to 9%. And also, nonpartisan Center for Responsive Politics in Washington estimated that when you look at the amount that business interests spent in the 96 elections as compared to labor interests, business spent $7 for every $1 spent by labor unions. And that doesn't even count the following ratio. If you look at so-called soft money, where business or labor will spend money not to a candidate, but on a candidate's behalf, the ratio was 17 to 1. So today's resolution is like asking whether the Mets scored too many runs after a 17 to 1 loss. If the decline in labor membership continues unabated, and union membership is only 5% of the national economy in 2005, that will be a tragedy, not only for workers, but for all of us, because I don't know a civil rights or consumer rights or environmental justice bill that was enacted without the help of labor. Finally, it's funny that critics are shocked, that union members through their unions contribute politically in contributions. Get real. You may not like it, and I don't like it, but our democracy is not so much checks and balances, but checks and more checks and some cash. And if business gives, so will labor members.
All right, thank you, Mr. Green. Mr. Buckley.
Ms. Green, if I understand you, your implied axiom is that as long as you can prove that the labor unions gave less than business, that's okay.
Well, since your resolution is they're too powerful, compared to what? One suspects management. And those numbers are strong evidence that they're less powerful than their adversaries politically.
The question of power can apply to a very small unit. You might have, let's say, a union with 1,000 members whose leadership exercises inordinate power. It would be legitimate to investigate that question without relating it to other unions, would it not?
I was trying to focus on political power. It is true a small union could go on strike and stop a great industry. But that happens more often in France, where union members are more numerous and they have national power yep. out of a socialist tradition than in our country, where I don't remember the last
Mr.
national
Green,
strike
Green, you,
that
you,
worked.
You've been using the figure seven times as much money was spent by business on the election, and then you failed to make, it seems to me, the obvious correlation, which is that there are seven times as many non-union members in America as there are union members. And yet the leverage exercised by union treasurers is inordinate given the political sympathies of the constituency. This seems not to interest you at all. You just keep thumping on about how much money the National Association of Manufacturers gives. Who cares? This is irrelevant to the question.
You reflect why you only got 13%, Bill, when you ran for mayor. Candidates care. Bill and I always compare our statistics politically. I assure you, candidates care who gives and what amount. And since all union treasuries in America added up are $5 billion, and the net wealth of American business is probably $3 trillion, I would argue that's disproportionate political power. Now, non-union members have power. They can contribute their time voluntarily, or they can contribute gifts. The power of unions in 96 was mostly negative. They stopped the chamber and the Gingrich community from tax cuts for the wealthy to subsidize Medicare cuts. And you're angry not at the power of labor so much as the positions of labor. Ideologically, I understand that, but it's not a principled position.
Mr. Jasinowski, or Professor Williams.
By the way, this makes for another show. You shouldn't say Medicare cuts and reduce in the rate of spending increases. Now, tell me something.
Yes, sir.
Do union people care about the air that people breathe in Mexico? Do unions kind of love Mexicans?
Well, you're asking a rhetorical question.
No, I'm just asking because
I haven't asked 16 million workers their views on Mexican air, but my guess is because American labor has led the fight for environmental justice and a strong Clean Air Act, they care about what people in America and in Mexico breathe in.
Yeah.
Yes.
And that is a joke because all that you really care about is that you want to raise the cost of doing business, producing things in Mexico, so that they will not be able to undercut on the U.S. market. That is, we have all kinds of environmental laws here, worker safety laws, that raise the cost of doing business. Now, I don't know whether it's a good or bad, but the fact is you're trying to export those laws to other countries to raise their costs so that they can't send cheaper goods over to the United States and perhaps bid out the job.
Isn't that right? Yeah, I'm a market-oriented Democrat, unlike you. I believe the costs of production should reflect all the costs of production, land, labor, capital, and pollution. When you allow a company to pollute in either country, then the cost of hospitalization for emphysema, for lung cancer, go up. And the investment that companies have made in environmental protection locally have yielded a fivefold return in reduced hospitalization and illness.
You care about Mexicans and Indians and stuff like that. You really care about their health. You want to tell everybody
your rhetorical
that the
point is over.
Care about those people.
I do.
Mr. Jasinowski. Mr. Jasinowski.
Mark, you said you're a market Democrat, and I assume that you continue to run for various offices here in New York State. And I assume you agree with me that we now live in a knowledge economy with the new rules and that we have got to do all these things
to
change and improve.
You've got to stop assuming and ask a very short question.
And my question to you is, do you support compensatory time, team working in the workplace, tax cuts, reforming Social Security, any of these things that matter for the 21st century, or are you on the old line of just a bigger government?
Since my job in New York City is to shrink the government, I'm against wasteful bureaucracy, and I am for tax cuts. You seem to imply the only cuts that motivate growth are cuts to capital. How about tax cuts to workers, and how about, as you began by saying, more employee stock ownership, more stock, and more say, because we want to give incentives not only to CEOs, but line workers as well.
Thank you, Mr. Green. There was a great danger of agreement there. So we'll move on to Mr. Buckley's opportunity to be questioned by the opposition panel. Mr. Kuttner.
Buckley, you've put forward a proposition that labor unions have too much power. Could you imagine an opposite situation where organized business had too much power and both parties sang the song of organized business because organized business wrote most of the checks?
I'm thinking, because you might say the American people have too much power. After all, the Bill of Rights is precisely to keep the American people from doing certain things which under certain circumstances they might want to do. You have too much power if you can force people to do things. Labor unions force people whose inclinations are Republican to contribute from their salaries to vote Democratic.
And organized business doesn't force its workforce to do anything it doesn't want to do?
I'm not aware that it does.
No.
I'm not aware it does. I'm certainly aware that, in fact, I can't think of any business, maybe you can, that has the authority to take from the wages of its workers and contribute to the Republican Party. I'm just not aware that.
Isn't that what soft money is? Money above the line, above the bottom line, that is given to disproportionately the Republican Party.
If you say, can corporations give money? The answer is, of course, they can. They can give it to the Red Cross, and they can, under certain circumstances, with certain limits, give to political parties. The whole idea of soft money is, I think, not a field which you really want to investigate. Mr. Becker.
Mr. Becker. Yeah.
Mr. Buckley, I just came from a legislative conference in Washington with the leaders of our union gathered to consider things. Before we started the meeting, we all stood and we pledged allegiance to the flag of the United States of America. We do this quite commonly in the union. All of our conventions start with singing the national anthem and the Pledge of Allegiance. Yet I'm aware in this very controversial world that we live in today with corporate boardrooms and the shifting of jobs and shutting of plants down and downsizing and sending products to America. Do you think it would be a good idea if corporate America would pledge the allegiance to the flag of the United States of America before every board meeting? And would you support such an initiative?
I think I really think, in a sense, that's an unrewarding question, because a lot of public recitations are simply done as a matter of sort of conventional ritual. There were, as you may remember, it was a little bit before your time, some labor unions in America that followed the Communist Party line. They were eventually ejected, thanks to the stamina of Mr. Amini, but they recited the Pledge of Allegiance.
The answer is,
I don't care what they do in corporate meetings. My interest as a shareholder is that they contribute to productivity and make a profit and provide minimum unemployment.
Mr. Shrum.
On the basis of your answer on the Pledge of Allegiance, would you like to retrospectively endorse Michael Dukakis for president in 1988?
Why?
Because one of the major issues used against Mr. Dukakis was that he did not want people to have to say the Pledge of Allegiance. Not be compelled to say it.
Yeah, but the trouble with that situation, you've got to put it in context.
The
context of Mr. Dukakis was that he was being anti-conventional in a provocative way, and he was. If everybody here wants to the Pledge of Allegiance and I sit on my behind and refuse to do
so. No, that's not what he said.
I'm being provocative. And that's what Mr. Dukakis was being. So people, I think, were very sensible in voting against him, even though he wrote some very good speeches for him.
Mr. Green.
Bill, you had said before in response to Bob Kuttner's question that it would be unprofitable to pursue the issue of soft money with that threat. Some of your colleagues have wondered why there are coerced contributions from union members who may be giving to Democrats when they are in fact Republicans, and they should have a way to opt out. And they do have a way to opt out under the Beck law. Do you think shareholders who own the corporation should be polled and given notice every time a corporation gives to a candidate or makes a soft contribution also?
I rejoice in the fact that people can be replaced if they don't meet the satisfaction of shareholders. I would like to see much, much more energetic shareholders. But I believe with Milton Friedman that on the whole, corporations should not give money, however beneficent the design, philanthropic or whatever. They have other responsibilities. So I'd see you. I might even raise you on that particular issue.
Bill, I respect that you don't think they should. But since last year in the 96 cycle, businesses spent $171 million for soft money, your belief notwithstanding. Do you think they should ask shareholder approval, like some of your colleagues think union presidents should seek member approval?
Well, I've seen no complaint about it. The labor union spent between $300 and $500 million.
Is that according to the National Review?
In estimated value of their efforts on behalf of the Democrats. And you can understand that people who felt differently on certain issues should feel free to propagate their positions.
Thank you, Mr. Buckley.
You're very welcome.
You can sit down. Mr. Shrum, Mr. Green.
In 1994, 40% of union members voted for Republican candidates for Congress. Given that, do you think it's democratic fair that virtually 100% of union money went to Democratic Party candidates?
Well, first of all, I would say in 1994, the Republicans provided a total disinformation campaign. So they were going to cut waste and fraud in the government and reduce people's taxes.
Well, that's a good argument.
They got into power, and it turned out, Professor Williams, they did want to cut Medicare. That is, they were going to slow the rate of growth so much that premiums were going to go up by $1,000 a year for old people. That's an increase for the old person, maybe not
against,
for you.
That's an argument against
union members.
Mr. Trump,
union members.
Taken in.
Union members, when they saw what Gingrich and the Republicans were doing, voted overwhelmingly against them in 1996. Number two, you can opt out, as we just pointed out. And number three, I'd ask you the same question that was just asked of Mr. Buckley. Shouldn't we then, if you want to establish an equal playing field, take a survey of shareholders before companies give out hundreds and hundreds of thousands, indeed hundreds of millions of dollars in contributions?
Let me ask you just this. If you agree that union members should be able to opt out, then why did the labor movement support Bill Clinton's decision to take down the notices at workplaces that they had a right to opt out?
Oh, you just want to have notices put up everywhere. I'll go back and ask you again. Why don't we compel corporations to send a notice to every shareholder that there will be a vote on whether or not they're going to give money to a certain candidate and not allow the corporation to do that? Let's make the rules equal. You want to have equal rules? Let's have them on both sides.
Unfortunately, you're not allowed to ask questions. Professor Williams.
By the way, unions love the notices about the minimum wage, but not the Beck. But anyway,
who put up the notices about the minimum wage? You know who put up the notices about the minimum wage? Because many corporations might not have paid it if the notice wasn't up there for their workers.
Okay. Do you believe people should be denied jobs if they don't join the union?
Not because, you mean if somebody goes into a workplace, it is a unionized workplace, and after a certain period of time they refuse to join the union?
Yeah.
I think that people who go into that situation have exactly the same obligation as people who live in the city of New York and enjoy the services of the city of New York. They ought to pay taxes to the city of New York, and people who go into such a workplace ought to pay dues to the unions that represent them.
So you don't believe in freedom of association?
I believe in a combination of freedom of association and majority rule, which I take it, by the way, is the basis of the whole American system. If a majority of workers have voted to join a union, the union represents the workers. I don't think there should be free riders, no.
Oh, I see.
Mr. Jasinowski.
Glad you do.
You've said on a number of occasions, Bob, that you're for a growth agenda. If you're for a growth agenda, you've got to cut taxes, you've got to make government smaller, you've got to invest in education, you've got to expand trade. An agenda which, for the most part, I suggested earlier, the leaders of organized labor have opposed, as you know. What is the growth agenda that you support if you're really interested in empowering and making workers' lives better?
Well, let me give you one example because you mentioned invest in education.
Yes.
You and the National Association of Manufacturers are supporting a tax bill that would distribute most of the benefits, not surprisingly, at the top of the income brackets. President Clinton has put forward a tax bill that would allow more kids to go to college. provide more hope scholarships for kids who maintain a B average, and the Republicans have cut most of that out. My growth agenda is invest in education.
You know, in fact, I'm glad you raised the tax bill, because the top 20% would mean that the rich that get included in that are people who make above $50,000 a year. Now, the average steel worker, the average worker in manufacturers, total compensation is about $50,000 a year. Why is it that you are, in fact, against the tax cuts that would be for people who are $50,000 a year, Bob?
I love it when you guys play that game. So I looked up a statistic just for this debate.
Good.
In the 1980s, with all of the Reagan tax cuts that you love, 1% of the people got 80% of the increase in wealth, and 80% of the people got, you guessed it, 1% of the increase in wealth.
Do you know, Bob, that the top 20% pay 75% of the taxes in this country?
Of course.
Of course they do. And whose money is it?
The largest benefit, what you mean, whose money is it?
Well, whose money is it? It's theirs. Why should you or labor or management
decide? So are you against any taxes, Jerry?
No. I'm against people who say that if you make more than $50,000 and you're in the top quartile and you're in fact paying 75% of the tax, you're rich.
I'll make you a deal, Jerry. Let's do the tax cut for people who make 50 to 100, and let's cut it off at $100,000, so we're not, or $150,000, or even where Mr. Buckley probably is, $500,000, so that the very wealthy people aren't getting it.
I hope that you'll call for it.
Mr. Green. There's been some discussion about the percentage of workers who would like to be members of unions, and some poll said that one-third would be favorably disposed to that. That means two-thirds would not.
That's one-third of non-union workers.
Right. And
yeah,
that
people one
minus one-third is two-thirds right. Who would not be favorably disposed to joining a union, and unions have fought for a rule which says you have to have a majority vote in favor of
The bargaining unit is not the country, Mr. Green. The bargaining unit is individual places. Let's go out and have free elections where management doesn't have all the advantages.
Okay, let's cut it off at that point. Thank you very much, Mr. Shrum. Thank you, Mr. Green. Mr. Jasinowski and Mr. Becker. The Steelworkers Union and the National Association of Manufacturers. And the National Association of Manufacturers will start by questioning the Steelworkers Union.
Well, I want to, first of all, congratulate George on his leadership and many of the fine things he's done. One of the things that you've done at U.S. Steel is empowered workers so that they would improve quality, and organized unions can do that. But the question I have is, why at the national level are you not supporting those things that workers care for? I think, first of all, Bill's point about all this political spending, I'd like to give you an opportunity to answer. Why is it that if 40% of the workers vote Republican, you folks use $35 million worth of ads to demagogue the Medicare issue by suggesting you were going to destroy it, when in fact the Republicans simply wanted to reduce the cost of the increase that's going to bankrupt us all, including workers? Why are you getting so far into the political game, George?
Let me back up first to what you said about U.S. Steel. We had to bargain this with U.S. Steel. This was not something that was just imposed, this workplace democracy and the cooperation and the participating teams. We had to bargain that very strenuously with U.S. Steel. And it is a success.
It's a good example.
And the workers do run it. And we do this in many other places, virtually all of the integrated steel mills and aluminum and master bargaining agreements we have.
I know you do.
As far as so we're a believer in this.
Right.
But we're a believer in having it structured in a way that there's some protection for the workers. And U.S. Steel agreed to do this. That's how we have the program. As far as the political
Yeah, why are you getting so far into the political game, supporting only Republicans?
Well, let me just turn the question around. Why is the National Association of Manufacturers? You represent 13,000 companies. You speak as one voice for 13,000 companies. You issue press releases when you're able to defeat something on safety and health. You issue press releases when you're able to turn back striker replacement legislation. You function much as what we're trying to do. But as long as the Republican Party, the leaders of the Republican Party, is determined that they're going to destroy the labor movement, and let me make a statement on that. Since the Wagner Act was passed back in the mid-30s, industry, corporate America, has never, ever accepted the right of the union to exist as an institution. You've tried to destroy it from that moment on. And as long as you're in there trying to pass company unions through the TEAM Act, as long as you're in there trying to pass comp time, which is an employer-friendly bill, not a family-friendly bill, as long as you're trying to pass NAFTAs and the extension of NAFTAs into other countries, we're going to be in there politically. You put us in there politically. You did.
Well, we put... The problem, George, is that what you're doing on the factory floor to empower workers, you're not doing in Washington. You oppose tax cuts. You are against changing Medicare or Social Security. You don't want any regulations changed. You don't want a smaller government. You don't want comp time. You don't want, the list goes on and on. You've gone from being for progressive things that would improve the lives of workers to a group that is a defender of the status quo. What reforms that you used to be for, that Bob talked about, are you for now?
Let me put it a different way. You represent the National Association of Manufacturers.
Right. We've got 90%.
The steel industry is touted as one of the most effective, productive steel industries in America.
It's quite
the automobile industry is the same way.
Right.
They pay high wages, they're unionized.
About $50,000 a year.
In what way, in what way was union too powerful?
It wasn't,
I mean,
there.
How did this?
It wasn't.
Oh,
in
you're
fact,
talking about something else.
I'm talking about workers who were powerful at improving our competitive comeback and contrasting it with union leaders who want to oppose any change in Washington that would help
we
workers.
We constantly seek change in Washington.
Yeah,
Jerry.
It's
we
change to defend the
we
status quo.
We constantly seek middle ground on these. But when we're faced with it, when we're faced with an administration or a Republican leadership in a House and a Senate that is dead set on destroying the effectiveness of the labor movement and a voice for working people, we are bound to fight that, and
don't
we
you,
will fight
don't
that.
Don't you think we should reform Medicare and Social Security before it bankrupts our system and makes our children live with a kind of debt and a defaulted system which is bankrupt, George?
I would like to start with reforming the attitude of the corporate America and Wall Street and shipping our jobs to South America, to Chile, to Brazil, and to Mexico.
Mr. Becker, you can start questioning Mr. Jasinowski, and Mr. Jasinowski, you can start answering a question with another question. Go ahead.
I would like to pose the same question to you I posed to Mr. Buckley, because I feel very sincere about that, about the Pledge of Allegiance. You speak for corporate America. You speak for industry. How would you feel about going forward with a resolution and supporting and pushing that corporate America, the boards of directors, would encourage and be required to pledge allegiance to the United States of America before the start of each meeting?
I think it is symbolic, as Bill said. I don't see any harm to it. I mean, I think I was at the tennis matches last night. We got up and we had the national anthem, and I think every time you do that, it's good for the soul, it's good for the community. I think what we ought to focus on is how do we bring stronger jobs to American workers? And in doing that, I think you've got to pursue agenda for the new economy. You've got to talk about incentive compensation that provides stock to workers so that they feel that they're sharing in it and are more committed than ever to being competitive. We got to trade. Let's do the things that will ensure that we have jobs for Americans rather than just symbolic things, George.
That's precisely what I'm talking about, and it's not symbolic. I just came back from Mexico and toured the maquilas in two different places, once
right.
in Texas and one in California.
Explain what a maquila is.
Part of the maquila doors. This is the started out as the trade zone right on the borders, in which product could be from the United States before NAFTA could be sent to Mexico, and there would be no value added other than work assembly and that kind of thing, and they could bring it back to the United States without paying import duties.
Right.
This area is Mexico, but in truth, it's not Mexico. Across the border, in truth, it's Mexico. I mean, it's the United States. These companies are building beautiful plants.
What are the questions, George?
In productivity plants, and they're built by industry in America. And because some of the corporations are moving from the United States down
so
there.
So what's the question?
They pay their workers 34 pesos an hour. Uh-huh. You're talking about saving jobs. How can industry,
that wants to keep a job in the United States? How can they compete against 34 pesos a day for 9 hours a day?
Let me give you one fact, George.
How can they compete against
that? Let me give you one
that?
Fact about the new economy. 97% of the consumers of the world, 97%, live outside the United States. That's where the money is, George. And if we want to sell our products and increase our exports and increase our jobs, like we've been doing, a third of our growth over the last several years has been from exports. You got to think global. You got to think global, because that's where the money is, like Willie Sutton said.
The greatest expansion in the history of the United States was during the 50s and the 60s. This is when we built the middle class in America. This is when we were able to achieve a higher standard of living. An ordinary worker could own a car, could buy a house. They could send their children to school. That's evaporating today.
We can
during
return
that period. And this was during a period that we did not have free trade agreements. This is one of during a period in which we had managed trade for the benefit of the citizens of the United States.
97% of the customers of the globe live outside the United States, George. You got to sell to them. That's the way the world works.
Because we let it work. Jerry, every steel company in America today, every integrated company is hooking up with steel companies in Mexico in one form or another, either distribution
that's
systems.
That's part of the new economy, George.
And, okay.
You may not like it, but that's the way it is. You've got to be around the whole world.
I think our leaders of this country have a responsibility to protect the well-being of the citizens of this country.
The way you do that is you learn how to compete better.
Thank you very much, gentlemen. Thank you very much, gentlemen. Your time is up. That wasn't hard, was it? Mr. Buckley and Mr. Shrum, the two chairmen. And Mr. Buckley will start by questioning Mr. Shrum.
Mr. Shrum, we're here to maintain that labor unions are too powerful. You do acknowledge, do you not, that it is within the power of a labor union to call a strike of hospital workers?
Yes.
Should they have that right?
Sure.
Okay. And they can also call a strike of the police.
I think that's a much more complicated question.
Yeah, and they can also call a strike of the post office.
One might not notice the difference under your view of the post office.
FDR, to whom you have reverently referred several times tonight, said that there ought to be no right of a labor union to strike against the public.
That was Calvin Coolidge in 1924 during the Boston police strike.
He said that. It was reiterated by FDR. And it wasn't until 1962 that Executive Order 10888, signed by President Kennedy, authorized the unionization of the public sector. Now, do you acknowledge no public right against the right of a labor union to approach a bargaining situation with that kind of leverage? Do they have the right to simply freeze the controllers while you're on an airplane? Or do you need Ronald Reagan to bail you out in situations like that?
I think it is a very complicated question that depends very much on the whole question of public health and safety. The controllers' question was difficult because the truth was they could inflict a lot of economic pressure without threatening people's health and safety, but what it would have required was that the airlines not fly. And President Reagan, of course, sided with the airlines. But I think there are some cases where it's pretty clear that unions probably shouldn't strike.
Well, let me simply say that I disagree with you, and I agree more with the tradition of Coolidge and FDR, which is that one has to accept certain natural limitations on the exercise of leverage. We don't believe that corporations should have the right to starve people. We don't believe that people ought to have the right to suspend the oxygen in the intensive care unit. But that right formally exists and has never been philosophically rejected by you.
And has never been exercised.
Find the question
no one has ever turned off the oxygen in a hospital unit. Can you think of a single case where what you're worried about has happened?
Oh, sure.
Why don't you explain it?
Well, If an operation is postponed, as many were in 1964 in New York City because there was a threatened strike, that is the effective leverage of the kind I'm talking about. You don't have to wait till the stomach is bared before you turn off the lights to make that an unsupportable.
As I remember that, all emergency operations and all urgent operations went forward. Is that not correct?
Well, maybe I was talking about a non-emergency operation.
Yeah,
and it's only emergency operations that you're worried about. Okay, so you can see that there is in New York State, as you know, a constitutional provision that forbids strike in the public sector. It's largely ignored, but it is nevertheless there as a result of the Democratic assertions of the voters.
Bill, I tried at the outset to partially agree with you in the sense that I do think there are circumstances under which it would not be justified to have a work stoppage.
Okay, so
but you parade horribles that you can't provide an example of.
All we're saying is labor unions are too powerful. They have too much leverage.
I think you'd have to come up with one persuasive example before you could assert that. Now let me turn to my questions. You were nodding quite vigorously, actually. I was watching you during Professor Williams' disquisition on bargaining power. So let me ask you about the sweatshops that exist just blocks from here. Do you think the workers in those sweatshops have a lot of bargaining power and could go to another job? Or is it just your view that they like sweating 12 hours a day for very low wages?
I don't think anybody likes sweating under the circumstances you described. Michael Harrington, running for president on the socialist ticket, told me that he thought there ought to be a law against picking lemons in Southern California. I said, no, there should be a law against lemons growing in Southern California. The fact of it is, if you are prepared to work, I am prepared to work, and you're prepared to hire me, the fact that there's sweat involved is something that I have to adjudicate. Now, I think it's extremely interesting that
But Professor Williams' assertion was that, like you, like him, all workers had a kind of bargaining power that allowed them to get fairer and better treatment.
No, fair is a loaded word.
In your world, it is, I think.
No. Secundum est mationem fore, according to the estimate of the marketplace, something is fair or is not fair under the context. What we consider unfair today would certainly not have been considered unfair 100 years ago and would not be considered unfair today in Pakistan or Bangladesh. The point is we have a free society. The point is that we ought to encourage that eternal tension between the infinity of desire and the scarcity of resources. And the fact that life can be and is extremely unpleasant is like the fact that lemons insist on growing in hot climates.
You know, I'm always fascinated when people who live pleasant lives advise other people that life can often be unpleasant.
More successfully in the speeches you sell than it really ought to. The notion that somebody who has worked, say, hard as a steelworker, okay, and has sent his children to college and retires with his wife comfortably in Florida, the notion that he should become the object of your contumely is kind of odd.
Well, you've just described my father, so he is certainly not the object of my contumely.
Well, I hope he knows that.
Let me move on to the next question. There are a lot of good companies that treat their workers, to use the word you don't like, fairly. But I think even you would agree that there are some who don't. Can you name three instances where you think it might be a good idea for workers in America to have a union?
Oh, I can name a million.
That you would favor them.
I'm in favor of labor unions whose role is contractual and who continue to render services as long as the people approve of how they are performing.
But that's ephemeral and philosophical.
The
is there a place
course,
where you yourself think there should be unions?
Look. American businesses, as I'm sure Mr. Jasinowski would agree, were for years stained by a kind of corporate avarice which gave them a bad name almost ongoingly. I mean, they would be capable of firing somebody the day before he walked into his pension. It's for reasons like that that you need social representation by labor unions. My point is the labor unions took something, went a certain distance and now are trying to go too far because, in effect, they have both the basic premises of socialism.
Thank you very much, Mr. Buckley, Mr. Shrum, Professor Williams. And it's the opposition's chance to question Professor Williams. Mr. Green.
Professor Williams, I'm trying to see if I can get a debate going within your side. Jared Jasinowski earlier said in passing that the extraordinary ratio between the CEO pay in the last two decades going up and line worker pay being relatively static, that it can be excessive at some point. I think the ratios are, it was 40-1 on average 20 years ago, and now the ratio of top to line worker is 140-1. Two questions. Would you have voted for an increase in the minimum wage all the way up to $5.25 an hour, which was enacted last year, to help close this gap? And second, is there any a ratio that would offend you, or do you always believe laissez is always fair?
Well, first of all, I would not vote in favor of anything that violates individual rights to contract, which includes the minimum wage. Okay. Moreover, so far as high CEO wages, I would not have any law against them either. That is, they're the stockholder, they're the board of directors' responsibilities. Now, if I don't like the wages that a CEO is getting for in a company that I hold a share, I will sell my share.
But don't most CEOs appoint the board that writes their ticket? And so in a sense, it's a self-serving public governance system.
But there are people looking over their shoulders. The Standard and Poor people, while we're up here debating, there are people looking at sheets to let me know this information. And I will just fire them by selling my shares.
So my
idea is that I believe in the maximum liberty for individuals. And I'm against government violating liberties. I'm against corporations violating. I'm against unions violating liberty. And so far as a question about unions that was asked my colleague, do I see a case where we need a union? Absolutely. I think we need a taxpayers' union to stop the exploitation of workers.
Professor Williams, you raised the delicate question of race and the role of unions in race, and I want to ask you two questions. First of all, do you think that the 1964 Civil Rights Act, which interfered with my freedom not to hire you, and the 1968 Fair Housing Act, which interfered with my freedom not to rent an apartment to you, were constructive or destructive to freedom of association and to the core principle that you believe in?
I think that the true test of one's commitment to, say, free speech is when he allows people to say those things that he finds offensive. The true test of one's commitment to voluntary human actions comes not when he allows those to be free to engage in voluntary actions that he thinks they ought to, but to engage in those voluntary actions that he finds offensive. Now, I personally find it offensive that someone would not sell me their house or rent me the house because I am black. But I will go to war to protect their right to have that kind of choice. Now, so far as the 1964 Civil Rights Act, I think it was a misguided document. The United States Congress should have said, with one sentence in 1964, that the Constitution of the United States applies to all of its citizens, period.
Mr. Shrum,
can I just have a
No, we're almost out of time, Mr. Shrum, very briefly.
Let's stay on the civil rights connection you established when you talked about, say, Social Security for a moment.
Very quickly.
Wouldn't it be better to take public health measures to raise the average life expectancy of African Americans rather than using that deplorable inequity as an excuse to attack Social Security?
Well, I don't know what you're going to do to make me live longer.
All right, on that note, thank you very much, Professor Williams. We ran out of time, I'm sorry. Mr. Kuttner, it's your chance to be interrogated by the proposing team. Mr. Green, would you like to start?
Yes. Earlier, Mr. Kuttner, you were talking about how Bangladesh needed and would benefit from unions because unions drive up wages. I wanted to ask you, in connection with that, how you would account for the fact that that the most dramatically fast-growing economies in the world of the past 20 years, namely Singapore, Korea, Hong Kong, Taiwan, and Chile, were notorious, according to the American labor movement, for making certain that their trade union movements remained weak. During that very same period, the economies grew at an extremely rapid pace, mm-hmm. and the wages of workers in every single one of those countries increased just as dramatically.
Yeah, I think you make a good point. That is to say, there is a high road and a low road to growth. Nazi Germany in the 30s had a very high growth rate. The United States in the 40s and 50s and 60s, when we had a strong labor movement, also had a very high growth rate. So you can have a strategy of growth that's exploitive, that doesn't share the benefits proportionally with workers, or you can have a more egalitarian strategy of growth. And within limits, that's a political choice. I choose a more egalitarian strategy of growth.
That would make sense if Hong Kong grew and Taiwan grew and wages in those countries didn't grow, but they happened simultaneously.
No, they did.
While there were, within a 20-year period, while there were weak unions.
Yeah, the, wages did rise to some extent after a lag, but capital did relatively much better than labor. Yeah, wages rose, but the rise in wages lagged the rise in productivity. Same is true of Mexico. It's one strategy of growth. It's not a particular strategy that I happen to like.
Mr. Williams.
One of your colleagues talked about sweatshops, and I'm quite very sure people sweat in steel mills, too. But when Mexicans come over here, let's say illegal workers, and they go into Los Angeles, work for wages that you and I, and under conditions that you and I think are awful, they sneak over here. Do you think you make them better off by taking them back over the border and putting them back in Mexico?
No, I think you make them better off by having a decent
I'm just looking.
Minimum
two
wage.
Two alternatives.
No, I don't
work
accept
at the sweatshop
I
in
don't
Los
accept
Angeles,
the premise.
Or you can put them back in Mexico. Which do you think they're better off?
I don't accept the premise. My alternative would be raise the minimum wage so that they can't underbid American workers and let them stay here.
Mr. Jasinowski.
You have said on a number of occasions that you're for an agenda that raises growth and improves the standard of living of workers, yet you've sat over there with the rest of them acting as if there's nothing that union leadership has done that's wrong, that they don't need to improve. It's a perfect thing. And of course, the fact that they've declined in membership is not relevant. Now, give me a break, Bob. Aren't there some things that the organized labor leadership could do better to reflect its workers that you think honestly, intellectually?
Yeah, it could organize more of your members and it could fight harder to do that.
That's it.
Mr. Barclay.
Mr. Kuttner, you've made several references, as have your colleagues, to the distinguished role of the union leadership in respect of civil rights. I just don't know. Are you aware that Jim Crow was as highly established in labor unions, certainly in this city, as anywhere in the South? The idea of finding a black person in the construction trade unions when I ran for mayor of New York was simply preposterous. It was kind of silly. So why do you simply assume that all in every situation there has been an enlightened point of view from the
I don't. And the whole society, with a few oases of exception two generations ago, was racist. Until the 60s revolution on race, that was the whole racial basis of society. The industrial unions were among the happy exceptions to that, and they led the way towards reversing discrimination in the society. Other unions didn't.
Thank you very much, Mr. Kuttner. The Green brothers now, Mark Green and Max Green, will question each other, beginning with a question from Max for Mark.
Mark, you were making the case that that unions were not politically as powerful as our side has argued, one of your arguments being that the corporations vastly outspent unions in the past election cycle. Are you aware of the calculations done by labor economist Leo Troy when you add in the staff time and the resources given by unions to political campaigns, that we're talking not about $35 million or even double $35 million, but we're talking in the neighborhood of $300-$500 million?
No serious analyst thinks that labor outspends business given the disproportionate wealth involved. It is true that union members, through their elbow grease, through their phone banks, through their leafleting, can spend a lot of time, and in kind, that's a lot of money. But you wouldn't possibly be implying that people who volunteer their time should be inhibited. We can and have tried to stem the contribution of money buying politicians. But you can, in a country of a free association, stop people giving their time.
Yes, but that's not what I was talking about. I, like, unlike many people here, have never been a member of a trade union, but I was a union staff member, and as a union staff member, I was highly involved in politics.
Good.
But that's the point. You were trying to get off this question as to whether or not union staff time that's worth hundreds of millions of dollars was spent on union elections, which dramatically increases the amount of money that unions spend in elections.
In 1961, in a Supreme Court decision, Justice Frankfurter said, hey, the Congress fully appreciates that you can't separate a worker's economic interests from his or her political interests. The two go hand in hand. And if business is going to lobby and work hard, you can't somehow expect to separate workers and their time or money from contributions also. And I don't think your interest is so much in protecting the views of the few union members. I think you're interested in silencing unions from having equal power or aspiring to
it
in a political marketplace.
All I'm doing right here is pointing out the fact that unions, despite the fact that they're shrinking, that they should be less politically powerful now than they used to be by virtue of the fact that they represent so few private sector workers. They're down to 10%, but still they're an important part of politics because they use union dues for contributions and they use the union dues to pay for the time of staff members who would get involved in politics.
If you'd excuse me just a minute. You know, you are on shaky legal ground here when you suggest that labor workers can do whatever they want politically and not run afoul of the election laws. I guess you know that.
Well, I've run, and I certainly know that. I was making a distinction between a gift, which is limited to $1,000 for a congressional candidate, and the donation of time and effort, which is unregulated if it's internal communication.
If I could just pursue my own question.
Wait a minute. They're going to fire me because I don't have.
That's okay. Let me just ask you this with regard to the politics of the American labor movement.
Sure.
The president of the AFL-CIO has described the situation in America as snapshots from hell. President Clinton, a Democratic liberal president, has just returned from a meeting of the advanced countries of the world. Hailing the U.S. economy as a model that others throughout the world should follow. Doesn't that suggest to you that American trade union leaders are out in left field?
You keep using left field. These labels are unhelpful when we're talking about...
If we're talking
about a new world economy, Medoff and Friedman showed in a book that Bob
Kuttner...
That
they're out of the mainstream. When their perception of reality is so radically different from that of a Democratic liberal president.
Answer the question, then start asking them.
Let us agree, I think, that unions in this country have increased the pay of their members, on average, 30% over non-union members. I think we'd agree with that, but perhaps not with whether the result is good. I think it's terrific that unions have increased pay, which helps create a middle class in this country who can afford the products they make. Do you agree that the increased pay that unions have created is a good thing? Or is it a bad thing because it makes us uncompetitive?
I think the studies that have been done, H. Greg Lewis and Albert Rees, show that the distribution between labor and capital is not changed by the fact that labor unions raise the wages of for some workers. So a United Automobile worker may make more money, somebody else may make less as a result by having to pay more for their car, for example, and not getting a wage increase. That's one thing. And then two is now we have 50% of the American trade union members being public sector workers. Where do they get their money from? They don't get their wages from the owners of corporations. They get their money from the public. So everybody, including and most of everybody else, are workers. So the half of the American trade union movement gets higher wages coming from the pockets of other workers.
I think it's absurd to argue that collective bargaining doesn't lead to wages higher for those who succeed in it.
I'm sure, by the way.
Capitalists would be surprised at that. Let me ask you a question. Earlier, George said that pay somewhat outstripped productivity gains in the 50s. I think it's pretty clear now that productivity gains are exceeding pay in the 80s and 90s. Would you like to see pay more linked to productivity, which may have hurt labor in the 50s, but helped labor in the 90s?
Well, I think pay is linked to productivity always. When productivity goes up, wages go up. And I dispute the statements that he's made about wages going down. What I do know about is the standard of living of the American people. And according to every single index that you can look at, the amount of vacation time, the amount of the percentage of Americans who own houses, the size of the houses, the amenities in the houses, the kinds of vacations that people take, the quality of the food that they eat, the quality of the air that they breathe, everything has improved over the last 20 years.
Except if you're a 30-year-old high school educated male worker. It is clear that if you look at 1970 to now, in real dollars, of course, not in absolute dollars, that the pay of such a man has fallen 20%. Now, does that bother you, or that's just the free market at work?
I think, first of all, if you take a look at the wages of workers, if you first eliminate those people who have at least reached through ninth grade of high school, you don't see any diminution of wages. Now, the fact is we live in an advanced economy, and you cannot expect people who have like a grade school education or less than a high school education to be making $25 an hour. Now, it might have been possible when we had an unskilled economy, when people learned a task on an assembly line like in 20 minutes and they repeated it over and over again the rest of their lives, but that's not, as Mr. Jasinowski was saying before, the kind of economy we live in now. And so now, like it or not, to get higher wages, and most Americans are doing that, to get higher wages, you're going to have to get more education. Well, and once people do get more education, the quality of their work life does improve, and the standard of living does improve.
You concluded a 1996 book, I might as well promote it, The Epitaph of American Labor.
Epitaph for American Labor, thank you.
With a sentence, the decline of American labor is destined to continue. Well, which is it? It's destined to continue and decline, or they're too powerful?
Both. There is destined to continue to decline in terms of the percentage of workers that they organize and that they can effectively represent in collective bargaining. As to whether or not they can be a politically powerful force, they can be. They are an extremely powerful special interest group whose power derives from dues money, you know, the members they shall have.
Isn't the special interest to help men and women who work for a living? Is that the special interest?
No, it's the special interest is to represent the interest of the institutions that they work for.
That was very cheap.
You're not paying me, so it can't be cheap.
Thank you, Mr. Green. Thank you, Mr. Green. It's time for closing arguments. We'll start with Mr. Shrum. Closing for the opposition.
I don't know where Mr. Green gets his statistics, but since 1973, income for young workers with high school diplomas has actually gone down, real dollar income, 25%. The other side keeps saying that they actually care about American workers and their standard of living. To hear such concerns so eloquently expressed from Mr. Buckley and his colleagues about workers is a classic case of the spider caring for the fly. This is especially true of Mr. Jasinowski and the National Association of Manufacturers. It reminds me of what President Kennedy said when he was invited to speak to them in 1961. He said it would be premature to ask for your support in the next election and untrue to thank you for it in the last one. I wonder if those on the other side would ever really support any meaningful unions anywhere in this country. And I would say to Mr. Buckley that if a union was good enough in Poland, and at least he did support Lech Walesa, then American workers ought to have that same unfettered right. Let's level the playing field for union organizing. Let's stop the company threats, the firing of union supporters, the endless litigation to keep workers from voting for a union that are forbidden in law but are prevalent in daily life. Mr. Buckley and Mr. Jasinowski are all for streamlining the legal process when it will protect corporations from being sued by the victims of dangerous and defective products like asbestos and the Dalcon Shield, but not when it will help workers get a union. In the end, of course, that is what this ridiculous proposition is all about. The balance of power in offices and workplaces, and the increasing imbalance of wealth in America. And Mr. Max Green is wrong again. In the 1980s, other first world nations grew as fast or faster than the United States, with higher percentages of their labor force unionized and a fairer distribution of wealth. The rich are richer there, but not by nearly infinite degrees. Today in America, we need more powerful unions so wages will once again rise, not stagnate or fall. We need more powerful unions working with management, as the UAW does with GM at the Saturn plant, to make America's companies more competitive and profitable by upsizing their productivity, not downsizing their workforce. More powerful unions, I suggest, would be good for workers, for the economy, for most companies, and in the long term, even for Mr. Buckley's stock portfolio. The difference is, the rising tide would once again lift all boats and not just Bill Buckley's yacht. Thank you.
Mr. Buckley, closing for the affirmative.
Mr. Chairman, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to class warfare. the notion that the argument rests on the economic achievement or salaries of the highest moneyed class in America strikes me as curious. We do have a case against Mr. Gates getting richer and richer if, in fact, what he controls is a monopoly. If he has an effective or inchoately effective monopoly on the sale of software, then it becomes a public concern and should be regulated under the relevant laws. We have no such case against Mr. Walton's family. There are plenty of people who can produce and sell groceries, which he did. And I don't understand the argument that the labor unions of power is in some way diminished by the success of Mr. Walton, or that we ought to be concerned with the with his salary, with his fortune. There is a horrible spirit, it seems to me, of central control here. What is desired is more government legislation, greater federal protections for labor unions. Our notion is that we live in a society which is pretty free and pretty prosperous. If you want to travel to countries in which the labor unions are much more powerful, take a look at Germany and take a look at Italy, take a look at France. Unemployment 12%, 11%, 12%, and relatively stagnant in terms of income. What is it that our labor unions would like to do that hasn't been done by the French and the Germans and the Italians with no effect? The productivity of America rests on a spirit which is dampened by increasing restrictions. Those come from the federal government in the form of taxation. They come marginally from labor unions to tell you what you can do, what you can't do, whether you can work, whether you can't work, and whether you are going to contribute to the Democratic office irrespective of your own wishes in the matter. The labor unions exercise too much power. We close our argument and do not have sufficiently in focus what are the true engines of the singularity of the American success, which hasn't got much to do with labor union achievements, but has a great deal to do with the achievements of those 90% of our workers who are not members of labor unions.
Thank you, Mr. Buckley. The Great Hall here at Cooper Union has been the site of many famous speeches, and one of them was by the famous labor leader Samuel Gompers. And I'd just like to read a small quote from that. And I hope, Professor Williams, you won't think I'm displaying any bias in doing so. This was in 1909 during a strike at the Triangle Shirtwaist Company, which is quite nearby. It was the site of the famous fire. "I have never declared a strike in all my life," Gompers said. "I have done my share to prevent strikes. But there comes a time when not to strike is but to rivet the chains of slavery upon our wrists. That's the kind of rhetoric that Mr. Becker is bringing back to the union movement. He was very eloquent tonight, and as was the opposition. The only question we didn't settle is the one that Mr. Williams raised about whether he is more handsome than William Buckley. But I think we'll come back to the Cooper Union or someplace and debate that one soon. I'd like to thank the Cooper Union, thank our panelists, thank Warren Steibel, the producer, thank Mr. Buckley, and thank the audience. Good night.
This program is a Warren Steibel production in association with South Carolina ETV. Funding for this firing line debate was made possible by grants from the John M. Olin Foundation and the Laurel Foundation. For a video cassette of this two-hour debate, send $49.50 to Firing Line, 2700 Cypress Street, Columbia, South Carolina, 29205. State the subject of the debate and please allow 3 weeks for delivery.
This is PBS.
For a transcript of this two-hour debate, send $10 to Firing Line, 2700 Cypress Street, Columbia, South Carolina, 29205. State the subject of the debate and please allow 3 weeks for delivery.